which is just as important. So there's like way too much to do. Like there's millions of dungeons, and this is all still in the first expansion. I mean, nothing new is coming out until May. But they update the game really frequently, and there's a lot of little quality of life things. We talked earlier about how there's stuff for colorblind mode and deaf people and all kinds of stuff. It got a couple of awards for actually being really helpful in that department. There's, you know, 8 different crafting classes, 3 gathering classes, and I think like 10 or so battle classes with 3 new ones on the way. Yeah, housing is pretty expensive. Yeah, I am the free company leader. So it is just me, Vanguard, and if you take a look at our silly little card... You know what? I don't think you've ever seen a Card Fight Vanguard card, by the way, JC. That's what our logo is, you see? With, like, the little 6-pointed star. Of course, I only got a 5-pointed star in our thing, but, like, that's what it's supposed to be. And, yeah, we got a house in the first neighborhood. This is Mist Ward 1. And we actually are the very first house you see when you walk into Mist. And for the longest time, we were actually closed to the public. So, yeah, very first house, like, you enter the neighborhood and you just jump. Of course, you probably, I would appreciate you not, like, banging on my roof. But, yeah. Here, I'll do another tour of the house for you. A lot of you guys, you know, are just recent add-ons. Everything in housing is actually put by us. So, like, we planted this tree, we put up this light post, we planted this farm, we maintain it. Granted, it's empty right now. These Chocobo stables are run by us. Even things like the color that everything is. I mean, if I go to housing and I go to remodel exterior, you can change, like, the wall, the windows, the color of them. You can do, like, the roof decorations. You can remove them. You can replace them. We've got a little butler out front that dressed like a Moogle. My little Card 5 Vanguard card is mounted on the plaque up there. The fencing is custom. All the stuff does things. Like, I can sit here and, you know, pump out my little water fountain. The cannon doesn't fire. That would be a little too cool. I can check my Moogle mail. Of course, I don't have any right now. I got a little training dummy that we can use to, like, determine how much damage I'm doing. But that's just the exterior. Inside, we have a smaller house, but I kind of like the smaller house because the items to space ratio is a little better. You can put 100 items in a small house, 150 in a medium-sized house, and 200 in a large house. That large house looks empty. But, you know, here again, we painted the walls. Like, these are custom walls that we like. We painted the floor. Everything installed here is all, you know, workable. We've got a little bell that summons our virtual butler. And he can, you know, sell stuff, go on adventures of his own, do things. Kind of a little bit of a brat. These crafting tables all work. They help out crafters level up their job classes. We've only got 4 installed. Blacksmith, alchemist, cook, and woodworker. Free companies are made when 3 people join up and sign a free company charter. And I think you have to pay a fee of like 25,000 gil each. Housing plots are still available in, at least on my server, even though it's a legacy server. There's still smalls available, there's still larges available, there's still mediums. Granted, they're not in, like, the original neighborhoods, they're in some of the newer neighborhoods that they've got, but, like, I mean, you can still build houses and whatnot. Got a little working clock, what is it? It's 6:20 Eorzea time, and the clock is pointed at 6 and 2, or rather 6 and 20. We have our little shop NPCs, we got Terrace. Hey Terrace. I don't think he's watching. But I'll wave. Have our little free company chest. I got a million gil stored away for the free company, just for like furniture and stuff like that. We also have things like spare minions. If you guys end up joining our server, you can have all these pets and more. Extra furniture, little bathtub, a whole bunch of fruits and vegetables that we grew in our garden that do various things, you know, change Chocobo colors or get used in other crafting materials. I built this dining set myself. It is actually comprised of 8 tables. So, like, you can see each little item here, including, like, separate dishes and the chairs. And I painted them, and I built them out of carpentry and whatnot. We have our sweet Garuda table, portrait of the Admiral up here. I built the fireplace. I got a fireplace and I enhanced it. Like, it's normally just the center fireplace, but I put the little side things on. Little table and chair set, you know, for plotting our next move, I guess. Just sit here. And the people at the free company actually use it. I mean, they sit around and they gossip and they chat. We're proud of our house. But each house also has... Oh yeah, Terrace is like making stuff, because that's what Terrace does. Terrace is much less about the battling and much more about the crafting. And so just kind of making stuff. We got an ethereal wheel. It lets us pump out little company enhancements, like everybody gets more EXP this week or something like that. Let me go to my private chambers. I mentioned that I heal mostly for my free company when we do like big dungeons and stuff. So I'm a scholar. Scholars use books. And I made myself a library. And so just like everything in the other room was an individual thing, the stacks of books are all individual. These anthologies, this is a three-tiered shelf. All of these are separate books, you know. What do we got? I think we have 8 rooms in the house right now. I mean, you can keep building and building and building. Let's see. Move to specified private chambers. Yeah, this list on the side where it's a 0-15, it can keep going. So everybody can have their own room. But we have, I guess it's 7 rooms because that girl moved out. But each room costs 300,000 gil. And it's a lot of fun, you know, just decorating and whatnot. I collect a lot of books, as you can see. Books, 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 books. I wanted to make it look like a messy library, you know, that I was figuring everything out. Oh, I forgot that I have my sweet Moogle book. Yeah, I collect books. That's what Scholar does. If you know what Ahriman are, they're like the Final Fantasy monsters that have like one eye. In fact, I could summon a minion. Oh, I have to show you my minion collection. Sorry, I'm getting all nerdy out. If you look inside of my Ahriman bookcases, there's a bunch of little Ahriman flower pots staring back at you. Thank you. The throne is from Circus Tower. It's costs a lot. I was lucky enough that one of my guildmates got the gem, and then Terrace, another one of my guildmates, like built the throne. Pretty hectic, but I mean, it was worth it. I think the throne is worth more than the house. But before I forget, minions. Okay, so minions are, they're just little pets. They don't do anything. It's kind of like WoW, where you have like the picnic baskets and the cool stuff like that from the card game. So what do I got? I got my... Can I move this menu? That'd be cool. I would love to be able to grab the menu and move it to where you could see my minions. Okay, cool. That's perfect. Oh, crapola. Okay, that's perfect. Okay, so then... There we go. Okay, so we've got... there's a lot of different ways to leveling up. Crafting has its own path, of course. Battling, there's little leave quests, which are kind of like, you know, slay this. There's fates, they're full active time events, basically random encounters on the world map, and everybody joins up, you get level synced down, and you fight. Fates never get empty because there's 2 paths when you're upgrading your ultimate weapon that require you to do specific fates and then just any fate you can find. So people are always doing that. That's a great way to level up. Dungeons are a really great way to level up. So, I mean, people are constantly doing dungeons, and the game is also added onto that list of things to do for the relic. Go back and do certain dungeons. So you always get qualified people doing dungeons. There's bonuses for doing dungeons for the first time. There's bonuses for doing dungeons randomly. There's a list where you basically hit the thing. It's like, excuse me, give me a random dungeon, and it gives you a random dungeon and an experience point bonus for it. So there's fates, there's guild quests, there's questing through the plot gives you experience points, there's a hunting log where it's kill so many of these things, kind of like your EverQuest style gaming, that gives you stuff too. There's experience point bonuses you can get from being in a free company or from resting. You know, you see my little bar here over on the side is like a green bar with a moon. That's because I'm fully rested. Granted, I'm level 50, highest level right now, can't do anything with that. But if I switch classes, you'll see that the green bar fills up the remainder of the yellow. What do I have that's like kind of up there? Yeah, like my alchemist. No, my alchemist is full. So yeah, you see that like the rest of the XP basically builds up. Yeah, I mean, there's just a million ways to level up, and that's true of crafters. There's all kinds of stuff. And gear progression's pretty static. I mean, it takes like a couple of weeks to get endgame gear because they set it to where you can only get a maximum of endgame points. But I'm happy that you're interested, because, I mean, I love it. So, Not that I am the end-all be-all, but it's enough to get me this excited about it, and I haven't been excited about an MMO like this since Final Fantasy XI. And let me tell you, this honestly made me see Final Fantasy XI in a whole new light too, because this does so many things that, like, I wish XI had from the first day. Including stupid stuff like, look, I can dye my gear every color of the rainbow. Look at how many shades of brown I have. Look at how many yellows. Look at how many greens. And I can also, like, dye all the gear, or just some of it, or I could be, like, metallic silver or pastel green or gold. And you can glamour your gear to look like other gear. So, like, hey, I like the look of the deer gear, but I don't want to wear PvP gear into endgame. Well, now I don't have to. And the PvP gear is actually pretty good, so that wouldn't even been an issue. Okay. Let's do two things at a time. I'm gonna show you all the minions I have, and then I'm gonna tour through the rooms so that you guys can see what other types of combinations you have. I got my Storm Hatchling. Dying gear, you unlock the dye gear quest. Somebody says, hey, you wanted to dye gear? You say yes. I'm like, cool, here's some dye. It's really that easy. Then you get dye, and you can dye any gear that can be dyed. And that's pretty much it. If you were playing like 4 hours a day, and you were just trying to get to max level, as long as the two things you need to do are follow the main plot line, and then the second you get access to multiple dungeons, you need to do the duty roulette, which is basically a daily bonus that you get by entering a dungeon randomly, and it pairs you up with random people, and it's a random dungeon from any list of a dungeon you can access, and you get a huge chunk of experience point bonuses. If you do your dailies, and it was just you just logged in, did the dailies, and progressed through the plot as necessary, I think you could probably hit max level in about 3 weeks of casual play. As long as you were just doing those itemized things. If you're exploring, maybe it'll take a little bit longer. But, I don't need that, but thank you. I appreciate the sentiment. And yeah, you're right. I just try to, you know, I just try to inform people. Because, I mean, that's what you're here for. You're here because you're like, oh, do I want to buy this game? Yes, you want to buy this game. But you don't know that unless I tell you. And I do this kind of stuff pretty often, so I'm used to just kind of preaching the gospel. But yeah, you could, and then the same thing with endgame, when you get to level 50, if you just did Circus Tower, JC, if you just did Circus Tower, like once or twice a day, which is like kind of like the endgame, item collection dungeon, you probably would be max level in, max item level, like ready to do endgame stuff pretty fast. Maybe, I would even say like a week or two, maybe sooner, because the way that item level progression goes, it all works together if you're just working on one job. You can get really far really fast. Now, as far as max level, which is like your 120s, which you'll see I have a lot of, see 120, 120, 120, 120, 120, they cost a certain amount of weekly points that are capped per week, and like this costs 2 weeks, this is 2 weeks, this is 1 week and some change. This is a week and some change. This is like about two-thirds of a week. These are two-thirds a week. Granted, high-level dungeons do drop stuff, so like that can save you some time. Crystal Tower drops some 120 gear. The World of Darkness drops some 120 gear that can't be upgraded to 130. The stuff that you buy in like the weekly points, that can be upgraded to 130. And then there's the stuff that's just stock 130 out of the box. So, I mean, you'll get there fast enough, and I think you'll get there. There's so much to do through each of the level progression things, and they make you go back anyway, that I think you'll be able to get there pretty fast. So, not only get there fast, but enjoy the stuff in the meantime. Minions! Where are my minions? Gosh. Okay, so Black Chocobo Chick and Princely Hatchling. You get this for being commended. Basically, somebody gives you, like, a thumbs up. And then I was looking at JC's message about her promise. Midgard Sormir, you get this one guaranteed from the plot. It's a little dragon. He'll sit on your shoulder, but I'm not going to give him enough time to. Bomb, you buy that one. And it's just a bomb. These are all like, they're just baby Final Fantasy characters. Baby Behemoth, you get with the collector's edition of the game. I don't have all the minions, by the way. I'm probably missing like 40 or 50 of them. But I just have like so many. The baby bun, I think, drops from, like, a fate or something. I don't remember where the Chigoe larvae comes from. The wide-eyed fawn you buy with your weekly points, so you gotta, like, sacrifice. But I did, because it's a wide-eyed fawn. The buffalo calf, I think you just get from a fate. The small shell I know you get from a fate, and it's got like a little Final Fantasy XI joke on the official item description, which is great. Because if you played Final Fantasy XI, you know this little dude. The infant imp you get from a fate. You have to get like a gold medal in it. The BDI you get from having subscribed to the game for a certain period of time, I think it's a couple of months. The fledgling dodo you buy with endgame points, and it's a dodo! The Coblin Larva, I don't remember. The Gugu Sproutling you get from the plot. The Bite-Sized Pudding you get from a dungeon. A lot of these you get from dungeons. The Demon Brick you get from a dungeon. The Kidragora you get from gathering. You have to grow the Garlic Jester. Like, we have a plot of land, and you can only garden if you have land, so if you need something planted, just come over and you can use my land. The Garlic Jester has to be grown from like a Mandragora seed, and then there's just a random chance he'll be a Garlic Jester, a Garlic Queen, a Garlic King, etc. You have to actually crossbreed your seeds too, so you have to grow like a lemon plant next to a honey plant, and then they have to crossbreed, and then you get special seeds, and then you plant those to grow. That takes a while. The Minute Mind Flayer, I think, might be a dungeon. The Wind Up Brick Man is from Dragon Quest. And you get that from the Dragon Quest event, which is no longer in service. The Demon Box can only be obtained by attending someone's wedding. And there's a tiny little scary monster under there that you can see if you let it go long enough. But eh. In the interest of time. And Kidu, you get from beating Gilgamesh. And it's a green chicken. The Mammoth you buy. The Storm Mammoth you get by beating... by completing all your hunting logs, by killing everything basically on a little scavenger list. The Kate Sith doll you get by pre-ordering the game, I want to say. The Gravel Golem you get. So some of these you can't get anymore. They may make them available in the cash shop later for a couple of bucks. There's certain minions you can only obtain just by straight up buying for like, I think it's like $4 a minion. I don't have any of those. They're usually like replicas of small characters from the side of the plot, so it's nothing you're really missing that's that bad. Don't remember the goblin. The wind-up Sahagin you only get from saving the fish people, and he's just a little wind-up, you know, stabby fish monster. Wind-up Shantotto from Final Fantasy XI you get from the Final Fantasy XI crossover event where Shantotto shows up. Wind-up a Diva you get from the Girls Day event, which if you like your Japanese anime, you've probably heard of Girls Day from like Pokemon or something like that. Hori the Snowman is from the Christmas event. The Wind-up Cursor, I think, is from the Collector's Edition. And like, it's a Wind-up Cursor. It's just like straight up Final Fantasy. And this one, if you leave going for long enough, he does like the Final Fantasy menu drop down and he scrolls past you. So he's worth taking the time to look at. Who else we got? The Model Vanguard you build out of robot parts from the Empire. He just actually like skates. The Wind-Up Airship. I forget how you get the Wind-Up Airship, but it's an airship. It's very retro Final Fantasy. The Minion of Light you get from subscribing to the game for a certain point of time, and like it's random. So here's like the Warrior of Light. I have, but there's still so many. Like my minion collection pales compared to other like people that I know. Yeah, so Black Mage, and you can see the White Mage above my head. The Wind-Up Leader is a subscription bonus, and it's based on whoever your leader is. You will be able to fly in the new expansion. They have 8 flying mounts planned already. One of them is a big dragon. You can also fly a black chocobo. They're giving you a personal airship if you buy the collector's edition. Wind-up Odin is pretty cool, actually, now that I, like, take a look at him. You get him from a subscription bonus. Wind-up Succubus you only get from spending those precious, precious allied seals. And if you do it right, she'll sit on your shoulder. I don't actually know how it works. I just know that if I, like, wriggle under her, she'll sit on my shoulder. And not, like, the way she's doing now. She actually sits on the shoulder, and you can, like, change job classes, jump, do anything. Come on. Any day now. I may not wait for it. Because I don't actually know how the minions that sit on your shoulder do it. I just know that you can, like, wriggle or whatever. She is, I think, 600 allied seals, but they increase the rate of allied seals that drop from each monster. So instead of being 20 from A ranks, it's 40 from A ranks. So she's kind of like 300 old economy seals. Like, it'll only take you about 10 hunts to get her. Or no, I guess she's still 600, so it'll take you like 15 hunts to get her, which is not bad. You saw I did like 4 hunts earlier and it was no problem. Minions. There's also a treasure chest from Allied Hunts. I got my Moogle. I think my Moogle was a pre-order. And if you get a bunch of Moogle minions together, they like swim in a circle and dance. Warrior of Light, I think it's a subscription bonus. And he's pretty cool. Very cool if you like Dissidia. The wind-up Onion Knight you can only get by beating 24 people in a lot on Circus Tower. It doesn't always drop, and if it does, you've got to compete against everybody. Wind-up Nymphelia came from the anniversary event, and she's just a NPC from the plot. Same thing as wind-up Thancred, just some guy from the plot. And then wind-up Gentleman you only get if you beat the whole Hildebrand quest arc, which is about a detective. You might have seen... we've got a framed picture of him on the wall. We all like him here. And then the next thing I said I would do is check out some of the rooms. You can see how different people decorate their rooms. I'll start just going down the list. Mine is a library. You saw I'm a scholar. I'm a main healer. So just lots and lots of books. This is our office. This belongs to the person who's in charge of gardening and gathering stuff. So I guess you thought, you know, she's... No, you don't lose your house. If you are the leader of a free company and you don't log in for 30 days, then the next person who's been there the longest is appointed as the free company leader. That is the only thing that you're penalized for not logging in. The house will always stay there. To detriment, because there's probably some houses that haven't really, like, nobody's mowed the grass in a while. But yeah, I mean, they don't take anything away from you. There's still enough open housing that, like, people have bought houses, and there's still a place for you to, like, you know, set up shop. So we'll go to Brooke's room. I think Brooke's got a pretty generic room. She's just... Yeah, well, this isn't too bad. She's got the serpent wallpaper. She's got the Immortal Flames floor. Some furniture, but it hasn't really been fully fleshed out, but you can still kind of see where she was going with it. Not our fanciest room. Move to specified private chambers. We'll go to... Oh, Zahawks is closed. Kasha's is a music room. It's also one that's not done, but it has a lot of really expensive instruments. Only Kasha can touch them because they're Kasha's room, but, like, the drums, you can actually play them. It just has, like, a pre-recorded MIDI. Same thing with the piano, the cello, the harp, and the marching horn. And she's just got a desk, and I think we're going to put some more manor furniture in here. That's why it's kind of got, like, the elegant gothic Lolita with the marble floor and the floral print. Move to specified private chambers. Gunther is really cool. Gunther's room. I'm a scholar. I made a library. Gunther is a monk, so he made a full little dojo. You know, he's got, like, the eastern plants, and he has a little shrine to Hildebrand. And yeah, he's got, like, the bamboo mats, and he just trains and he does his kung fu in here. Kind of a simple stone floor. They added some more oriental Asian style stuff, so I'm hoping that once he gets a chance to pick up some of that stuff, he'll add that. And then Rose is a summoner slash healer, and so she's got a carbuncle fetish, I guess you want to call it. And so, yeah, she's got carbuncle furniture up the wazoo. Carbuncle chair, carbuncle desk, carbuncle lamp, carbuncle clock that tells accurate Eorzean time. It's 1:16, and that's where the clock's at. A portrait of the Gridanian leader, who's, a healer herself, a conjurer. Carbuncle, Garuda couch, Shiva lamp, carbuncle. So you can really do a lot. PvP just queued up, so I'm going to go ahead and hit commence. It's 24, man. So we're doing 8 versus 8 versus 8 instead of the, like, if you've been with me through the stream for the 6 hours that we've been going, you've probably seen that PvP can get really hectic when there's a lot of people. This is going to be a small PvP gathering. It's just 8 one party versus one party versus one party. Yeah, it's cross realm. It's basically I was in a queue and it's a line of people that say, "Hey, I want a PvP. Check me in." PvP is in its own place. It's never on the free loading map. A lot of PvP actually isn't on the map either. It's all instance. You can get in by two ways. You can form a party and enter together, or you can sign up for a queue and from wherever you are on the map, your house. For instance, I was just in somebody else's living room. Yeah, the 72 man was crazy, but this is a little bit more intimate. I'm gonna change to healer because there isn't a healer already in this group. We're also on secure, so this is more about controlling bases than it is just killing people. The way this works is you'll see there is outposts, these little gray circles. You fill those in, you hold them, and then you also kill the robots in the center, so it does share that with the deathmatch mode. But in this one, losing the base can really upset the tide of battle because your points increase incrementally by the length of time you hold the base. So it's cool if you can hold two bases, but mainly you just want to hold your own base and then kill some robots. And so it's this is a lot more tighter. This is not so like landslidey like the slaughter mode. I do like the excitement of slaughter mode. This actually is going to take a little bit longer, but it's fun. Looks like we got two healers. We got a white mage and me versus my dear scholar self in my full PvP gear set. Looks like we got a ninja with spirit bond gear, I guess. That's weird. Maybe he just hit 50? I don't know. I don't know what's with the, let's see, we also have another ninja, we have some bards, mostly in PvE gear. I mean, like, I prefer seeing people in PvP gear because it makes me know that they're good at it, but in this version of PvP, in the really big front lines, the PvP stats don't matter because it's a hard cap of 80, so, like, everybody gets nerfed down to the same. No, there's no Horde Alliance-style PvP. Like, you don't just see people in the field and you're able to kill them. This is the equivalent of that. It has the same feel. It's more like, you know, the Battlegrounds or whatever from World of Warcraft, but you can't just kill somebody in the field. There are smaller PvP affairs that are like 4v4, and you can challenge people, but you cannot murder somebody. So everybody is friendly. I mean, they're politically tense, but they're not just, like, murdering each other. Murder is a big deal. So we've caught our own base, everybody's caught their individual bases, and now we are marching to the center to kill us some robots. I'm a healer, we gotta pay attention to health bars, protect people, but also I'm a huge target. Like, they're gonna wanna kill me first and foremost. So, I mean, there are different factions, to answer your question on that, but they don't kill each other. So here's our robots, they pop right at the beginning. You really wanna hit the robots on the edge, because everybody can get to their own robot in the center really easily, so I'm trying to do what I can as far as, like, caster DPS on Scarlet. Remember that ability I had to switch my healing power from the casting power? They thought that was too powerful in PvP, so they removed that, so healers can only do, like, whatever, you know, just kind of basic damage. I don't know where that guy was. Oh, he's at our base. Oh no, wait, no, where is Gene? Can't find him. Well, all the robots are dead. It looks like Maelstrom got two robots. Yeah, everybody got two robots, so it's basically a pretty close game. But the Adders captured our base, Flames captured their base, so I think really the place to go right now would be to go to the Flames base, but since I'm not on a melee class, I'm a healer, I need to support everybody wherever they're going. Thank you, Vexamir. You know, I wish you good luck in your Eorzean adventures. Okay, so we got our base back, and the Serpents got their base back, so I think smart money is head to Flames. everybody is going with me. Because we have a few minutes before the next set of robots appear. Granted, I'm using slang terms for everything. Like, they're elegant drones and blah, blah, blah. But you don't need to know that. I mean, they're robots. You kill the robots for points. If you do want to know about the lore and everything, I do focus on the game. And it's very vast history and whatnot. But I don't want to confuse anybody who's new. So, you know, just feel free to ask or let me clarify. I'm happy to do that. So... looks like all the blue dots are us. We can't see the enemy, but we're creeping. And so we're gonna go over to their base, which is guarded. And I see that I think our enemies are hitting us at our home point, but let's just get them. Let's do it. I'm gonna focus on... what I can do is I've got an attack that knocks people back. So I'm going to knock them as far from their base as they can while we capture it. Yes! Now it's unoccupied. The way it works is as long as more of us are in there than them. That was a terrible phrase. But as long as there's more of us than the enemy, then we capture it. So we've got their base, and we have our own base. And now we're holding two. The Flames have no bases. The score is up here. We're trying to get to 800 first. It's 163. Ooh, we're tied. But we're a point higher because we have two bases, so we get 2 points a second rather than 1 point, which what the Adders have, or no points, which is what the Flames have. So basically, we just want to hold this as long as we can. Oh, nope, we're going to mid. So this is a lost cause. And the reason why is because the points that you get in mid are where you establish your leads. If we get two robots, maybe three robots out of the six that appear in mid, like, we'll be in pretty good shape. The Flames are probably going to get their own base back pretty fast, but that means they're not going to be topside, so they're not going to be capturing bases, because right now, in order for them to get back in the game, they need to get their own base back, but that keeps them out of the mid game. So, you know, that's the way to do it. Oh, whoops, I'm attacking the fairy. Yeah, Flames just got their base back. We've got basically their whole ramp camp, so their path to get up to mid is pretty filled up. Meanwhile, though, Adders are showing up in force. He slept me, but I used my ability to get out of sleep. It's like once every 30 seconds, or once every minute. Healing! I'm using this wall, honestly, as just like a way to keep myself away from... when you're a healer, you're such a huge target, because the ability to heal people is so vital in PvP. Like, the white mage is getting his stuff kicked in. Okay, and then now we got this. I like that, like, Scholar can do damage, but it doesn't have any, like, crowd control, so white mage can sleep and I can't do anything. Well, thank you, I appreciate it. I try to be as Pharaonic as possible, I suppose. I just always loved games, and honestly, like, when I got into Yu-Gi-Oh! When I was a kid, I didn't think anybody was gonna like it. Like, I didn't think it was gonna blossom and be huge and be a pop culture phenomenon to the point where we're making, like, funny videos about it. Maelstrom got two, Adders got three, Flames got one. I'm gonna have this Dragoon chase me, and then I'm gonna knock him off. I just need them to chase me! Got him. I think I got him. Are they gonna fall with me? I got the Bard. Oh, but the Bard didn't die because the Bard didn't fall as far as I did. Rad. Okay, so maybe not as king of game as I thought. That's what I get. I always do that. I always, like, go way too ham. But that's okay because there was nothing left in mid. And back to base capping. Oh, I love Jaden! But there's also, like, so many new characters. Yuma, Yusei, of course, from Zexal and 5Ds, but also Yuya. Like, the new Yu-Gi-Oh! Series, Yu-Gi-Oh! Arc 5, is amazing, and you should try to look up, like, some subs of it or something. Mono subs, but it's not a good copy of it. It's also coming out in English, so if you just want to wait to get it the fair way, then you can soon. But Yu-Gi-Oh! Arc 5 is so... it's, like, retro, old school, and futuristic all at the same time. It's... But we'll save that for another stream, because I don't want to get too off down. At the same time, though, it is amazing. Just Google Yu-Gi-Oh! ARC V5. I think we're hanging around middle because the really giant robot's going to appear. Current score is 313, Maelstrom, 300 Adders, 300 Flames. So really close, only winning just by a little bit. And just a base capture in the wrong direction could offset that. So I think it would be nice to do some battle damage to people if we actually could kill somebody. I'm gonna start throwing in. Yay, my ability to wake up is still there. I'm just gonna jump down here. It looks like I'm like jumping off the edge, but what I'm actually doing is getting out of the way of all of them. And then I can heal myself. And then I can run back up the side to where basically they're not looking for me anymore. This is basically just like a way to flag myself, or unflag myself, get them away from me. Yes, get the Dragoon. Oh no, the White Mage got him. Yeah, there's nothing that can be done. Still leading by about the same 13 point margin, 334 to 321 tied. Go. I think you'll like Yu-Gi-Oh! 5. There's about 40 episodes of it now, and it has the same imagination that the original Yu-Gi-Oh! Series did. And interdimensional travel, and like neat characters, and it's just fun again without being like overly boring. Just get this Dragoon down. Now we just need this Paladin. Who's over there? There's a Black Mage. Yeah, we can mess him up. Oh, I'm gonna knock him off the edge. Here we go. Did I get him? I got him. I totally got him. There he goes. Splat. Okay, awesome. As long as I get one of those in a day, I'm happy. Because that's really the only way that Scholar can do enough. Oh, hey, I did not know. Well, there's somebody getting it back for us. We did take a hit on the lead. We're basically trying to camp the center because, there you go, we want to be the first there for robots. But it looks like mostly enemies up here, and I have a bad feeling that they're going to get all our delicious robots. I'm getting wailed on here by the enemy. Where is he coming? Oh, there he's coming from. Wait, no, it's a Scholar. Okay. Yeah, Twin Adder is going to get most of these, because none of us are even up here, because we got so focused on... Okay, wait, we got one drone. We're not going to get that one. The other thing is it's a good strategy basically to weaken drones to half health or more, because once you get 51%, you can't lose. So Maelstrom got one, Adder's got three, Adder's got four. Yeah, they're gonna win this. They were up top when we were distracted about our own base. But if we get this one, we'll come back. Not all of us are up here, though. I mean, there's so many, like, factors that I can't control, you know? Wow, they're really smart. They're actually limiting our ability to limit break by killing off the people who do the physical limit break, so they're good, you know? And that's the thing, I was telling you, the reason I like the smaller framework is because each individual thing counts a whole lot more. Oh, God. Wow, I got pummeled by, what was it, Circle of Storm Ruin? I guess they just jumped me. Whoa! Maelstrom got the node, 636 to 516. Like, come back out of nowhere. Okay, I don't know how we got the node. Maybe they were beating us up on us more than we were beating up on the node, which is fine. But, like, comeback potential. Like, not even comeback potential. We're winning now by a lot. Because it's 653 to 521 to 463. And first 800 wins, so, like... There's only going to be one more set of nodes. Flames, who are in last place by like 200 points, are currently messing with the Adders, who are our rivals. So like, that's fine. Let them fight amongst each other and we'll win. Like, awesome. I need 200 first place victories, or like my nation. I need to be present when my nation wins 200 times in order to get the next mount, which is a big giant robot. It's like one of the robots. You actually fly on one of the robots that you kill and whatnot. And so this is good. I just need this and 50 more wins, because 100 was the horse. 200 is the robot. So getting there. And I'm still like making more PvP sets. I've got 4,400 wolf marks. It's like 7,000 for like hats and gloves and stuff. It's 12,000 for a body piece or a weapon. And I think I'll probably make the summoner outfit. Summoner is another deer, just like my deer, but it's a different deer. It's like summoner and scholar both come from Arcanus, so they both made them deers because like, well, one of them's like it's actually like a deer, and the other one is like this elf ramish thing where it's got like more bowy curvy horns. Ill explained, but basically I'm gonna build another deer outfit because I love me some deer outfits. To 570. So yeah, if we get this next series of mids, we win. If we don't get this next series of mids, we'll still probably win. We just have to basically hold out. Also, Flames just captured Adders, which means they're both going to be busy by that, and they're not going to be up here like they're supposed to be, which is fantastic, because nobody's up here. Randomly, that was an easy win. Like, it felt bad, but I was worried at first, but now I'm not worried at all, so. But our tank died, so our base is captured, but like, guess it doesn't really matter. Yeah, because we just need to get this. If we get these, we win, because these are like 30 points each, which is ridiculous. Okay, that one's about to die, and that'll be another 30-point jump. Oh, no, it's only 20 points. Okay. I thought it was 30. So 730 to 640 to 573. This one's about to go. Oh, we didn't get that one. That was Flames. 7. To 599. Yeah, I mean, look at the progression that we're having. Every time we get one of these drones... 790. We don't even have a base, so I mean, we're doing this like wholly off of these drones. And capturing a base counts as 10 points, besides the 1 point each second you get for it, so like, yep, we win. Did I kill anybody? No, it doesn't count my knocking the guy off the edge of kill. Oh well. We win! And you see, I get like 20 of my weekly points, I get 50 of my whenever points, I get 600 PvP dollars. I don't get any PvP experience points anymore because I'm completely maxed out on that, so... Yeah, you know, PvP is awesome in this game, it just kinda is what it is. But thank you guys for taking an interest in it. If not, I guess we would be doing something else. Let's see, let us... do some of those boss battles we talked about. Nothing too crazy, but I'll take PvP off the queue. Take Leviathan Extreme off. I'll do hard modes, because like I just have this feeling that like we're not gonna be able to beat whatever comes up. I'll do the Dragon's Neck. I'll do all the retro ones. Oh hey, welcome back. Good to see ya. just doing random dungeons, or excuse me, random boss fights at this point. I'm not doing any of the No, that's Shiva. Pony Farm. I can do Rama. Let me do Rama. Scholar. Is Devil Scholar that great in this? I guess I could try. Oh, it's no longer accepting party members. I was like a minute too slow. So that moment where I'm like, well, I guess. I'm not really good at single tank Shiva. So I'll just do what I'm doing. Thank you, Capricorn. I'm actually in the retarded Chocobo outfit because I wanted to stand out against the green screen. It's actually, I'm not even that yellow. Like, you think it's like kind of a character off thing, but here there's blue. So I think my white balance is off. I'm actually going to reset it by holding that up to the camera. And I guess it kind of, when it gets all the blue in there, it kind of like reduces my skin tone back to its normal thing. Before I was wearing a silly Moogle hat, I have a collection of ridiculous hats, wigs, stuff like that. I do a lot of cosplay. If you're watching from Twitch, and I assume Capricorn, you probably are because you've got the little Twitch, like, I forget what it's called. It's the fast version. It's the I paid for Twitch, so please like me thing. And it's good. I'm glad you support this because it's a wonderful medium and I made a lot of friends today. But you probably can see things like my other costumes and the subscribe and the links and the follows, whereas other people are watching me from PlayStation Live, so they're just getting the little like comment and comment box. I think it's like a blue bar on the side. Chroma key is not hard anymore, and the other thing is this is actually coming straight from a PlayStation camera, so the PlayStation camera does chroma key. Oh, you are watching. Well, good for you for not only watching on PS4 but supporting Twitch, because you don't have to do that. You could have been doing on using the, what is it, Live from PlayStation app. I will say I'm pretty thrilled that, where's my PS Vita? Vita. Yeah, here it is. They just added, it's not full Twitch, but they did add the PlayStation Vita's got the Live from PlayStation app, so now I click Live. But, oh, looks like we're doing Battle in the Big Keep. I like that demon. I gotta get out of the habit of saying like bad words on stream. Let's see. Can I find myself on the list? I think I'm way towards the bottom. I'll probably go for another couple hours. I'm having fun, guys. Maybe I'll quit at like 9 o'clock, so maybe like 2. Where am I at in this mess? Commence battle in the big keep? Final Fantasy. Search. Yeah, there we go. Oh wow, I'm like the only Final Fantasy stream. Okay. But the point I was trying to make, it does look like I skinned a Chocobo. I'm sorry. And I guess my Moogle outfit. But that's pretty cool. So on the Vita, you can just see there's me, so that's pretty cool. I have to say, like, that's they did a good job on, like, making this an all-inclusive experience. And yeah, by the way, this is like some old-school hardcore NES music, or SNES, excuse me. Yeah, no, this is some like old school Final Fantasy nonsense. Let's go ahead and do my job as a tank. pull him over here. So my job is basically to keep Gilgamesh distracted while they beat up on Enkidu. And I mean, like, that is your mom's Gilgamesh. That is your grandpa's Gilgamesh. I mean, Gilgamesh is part of the plot, and I won't spoil it because it's a lot of fun. They also have a battle on the big bridge fight where you fight Gilgamesh on a bridge, and it is big. Come back here. Oh, whoops. Oh, okay, it's doing one of those things where, like, even though I'm the top person on the hate list, it still comes over to me for, like, no reason. Come back here! There we go. Get over here. There's not really a lot of places I can take Gilgamesh, so I'm just trying to stay over here in the corner. Yeah, first person helps, just when you're... I'm a chicken now, by the way. Chicken, 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 chicken. I don't remember how to unbecome a chicken. I think I have to, like, jump in a whirlwind. I also don't need to make all the party suffer because I'm a chicken. Okay, so I need to go find the tornado. Yeah, here we go. Where is the whirlwind? Okay, no longer a chicken. There's a bunch of retro fights. I should just go through the hard mode fights. I think I will do that because it's a lot less stressful. You saw when we did some of the harder content earlier, I could talk you through it, but that doesn't necessarily mean that everybody else was ready, and some of them wouldn't join the stream in order to get, like, full talk through. Woo! So yeah, I'll just do hard mode fights so you can kind of get, like, the basics of what the game has to offer. I think that's the best use of our time. And plus I'll be helping people since I don't need them. I just need the points from them. Although, if I get... how many more commendations? If I get 15 more You're Cool points, then I get a golden Magitek armor that I get to ride around in. So that also is pretty incentive to, like, tanks. It's a great incentive to tank fights for people. Oh god, it's big and it's glowy and I need to get out of it. Okay, so Enkidu is almost gone. And you can see his health bar, it's gone. So now we fight Gilgamesh. I think he just runs, right? Yeah. So, for those of you who are Final Fantasy V fans, Gilgamesh is known for what? For stealing weapons from people. So, would it be cool if you had a fight with him where he just... I don't know, whipped out every weapon from Final Fantasy XI and a few from Final Fantasy XIV. Now we fight like men, and ladies who dress like men. Transmogrifying time! I guess they didn't want to get sued for saying it's morphing time anymore. Are you ready? Let's do this. Got that old school Black Mages vibe now. It's pretty nuts, and there's dragons and stuff, and it's crazy. I think based on the fact this warrior stopped using his tank stance, that I'm the main tank. So I guess I'm main tanking. I'm gonna wait for Stone Skin 2 to go off, which provides Stone Skin to the whole party. Let's do it! Arr. Yeah, this is definitely, like, let me show you my true form. I'm gonna tank him right here, kind of close to the middle. Because I saw another tank do that when I healed this fight. I mean, it's okay. I mean, maybe I've got better gear than him. And that's what it is. Let me see. He's got so-so axe. Some I-120 gear. I mean, he's got, like, pretty good jewelry. And we've got pretty much the same as far as armor goes. But I've got a better weapon. So I guess that's what he decided. That's how we were going to do it. Man, that ninja is doing so much damage. I'm not having a hard time keeping hate, but like, I stopped focusing for a second and I did lose hate. You can buy subscriptions via PayPal, via, they do have game cards and they are cheaper actually. I think you can probably look up GameStop or Best Buy probably or something like that. There's various ways to subscribe. You can also buy in bulk, which is my favorite way to do it because you immediately get any subscription bonuses and whatnot, so. I'm gonna use Berserk, at least my attack maintain hate a little harder. Looks like the hate crisis is mostly over. You see the meters next to the names where it says A? Well, the A means that I have the, I guess, the aggro, the attention of the monster. But, that ninja's meter, he's number 2. He's getting up there. He was a lot more full, so I've significantly closed the gap, but just in case, I don't want to mess around. Fight a little harder. I'm just doing the empathy combo, depending on the healers to offset everything. So the way this works is I tank everything while they, meanwhile, they kill the dragon's heads, which, as you can see, are causing a lot of mayhem and mischief. Next time he jumps, I'm gonna reset him, like, by jumping. Yeah, here we go. Let me go to the door real fast. Gilgamesh for resetting your own position. Gilgamesh, using one of his many arms, is chaining up one of the healers. And they died, so much for that. But you can break them out before they die. Healers can heal the whole party and target certain party members. There's variants, different. Most of the healing is either like regenerative healing when it targets everybody, or it's like a shield that heals everybody for a certain amount that also protects them for a certain amount based on the healing done. You get more for your money by healing a single target. Basically, like, if you want to make everybody wet, you would get a single person more wet by pouring a whole pail of water rather than by splashing everybody a little bit. That's the best way I can think of this thing that, like, water. Oh god, I got caught in the Venn diagram or whatever. I just didn't want to, like, move Gilgamesh that far. Looks like we're enchaining somebody again, and our enchain target is... I'm actually gonna chip in by throwing tomahawks over there. He's hitting high rel again with the scholar. Yeah, this fight's pretty tankin' thing, honestly. I mean, you're right, there's nothing that's particularly amazing about this fight. If you want to see something really cool, Titan is probably the best example of like an exciting fight. Not nearly as much damaging or mechanics. Sometimes you just dodge stuff. And Titan is mostly dodging stuff. It's not a lot of like actual I guess like you have to do this in order to do that, but it's the most fun dodge fight in the game. So I'll probably queue up for Titan Extreme after this just because like I mean that is my favorite one. Coil is where you're getting most of your mechanics. Like, where you need to, like, offset this, or 4 people need to get hit by this, and 5 people need to get hit by that. That's where you get all your really obscure stuff. I mean, we were kind of showing that off earlier with the Binding Coil of Bahamut turn 5. But the problem is, a lot of people don't have all that stuff memorized. Despite it being a 15-minute fight, it can turn, you know, into hours and hours and hours. I will say the music really makes this play. But I should let him jump back to me. Yes, okay, my bad. Time to use some of these defensive cooldowns. I'm kind of getting hit a lot here. I'm also going to increase my own health. they did cure me by a lot, so I guess we're back on track already. I mean, for this being an optional boss that shows up only by getting to the end of a optional like side quest that's based on these jokes and stuff.